We'd like to start the next session, so please, if you will, come inside and take a seat. We'd like to begin with a short video sketch of Hari's career. This video was prepared by and a show. And the mic is not working?
Okay.
So, will you shall we start?
To doctors' writing, so it's a wide variety.
But
inside this machine, a scanner is furiously taking pictures of handwritten envelopes, sending the image to two little blue computer processors that read it. Sargur Srihari helped design the program.
It is done in the post office at the rate of about 15 per second.
That is 15 letters per second.
15 letters per second. 1/15 of a second, the entire address is decoded.
Here's how. First, the computer breaks down the address and tries recognizing the zip code, since people write numbers neater. Then it reads the state to confirm they match. Now, if they do, the computer then tries recognizing the letter shapes in the street name. It sounds simple, but just think of all the different ways even one letter can be written.
People write N's in different ways, with loops, without loops. It could be facing left, facing right.
It succeeds a quarter of the time and is always improving.
And this led to a lot of interest all over the world about what is this problem and so much progress going on. And so people today, even today, say recognizing handwritten pages by computer is the fruits of AI. So if you have a new idea in AI, can you recognize handwritten pages? You start there and then you go on to more complicated things. So it's the simplest organism you can think of as a test for AI. And to this day, when some of the greats in AI come out and say, I have a new idea, this is how it's going to be done. Well, okay, let's find out first on handwritten digits. And what's called the endless handwritten digits are used the world over as the standard today. And kind of, it all started when you're doing postal address reading here.
I started as a computer scientist more than 40 years ago. I entered the field of artificial intelligence, and there was a hubris at that time that, you know, everything human beings do can all be automated, that computers are going to replace human beings. This was 40 years ago, and I've been working in that field with AI. And then the way I got into forensics was we got a major project from the US Postal Service to develop a system for reading handwritten postal addresses. And at that time, people felt that, you know, I can't read my own handwriting. How can I get a computer to read handwriting, you know? So anyway, we worked on that system, and many, many people contributed to those projects all over. But we did the first system for that. And today, about 96 or 97% of all handwritten mail in the postal stream is read by machines. We allowed the postal service to continue to be in existence for a few more years than it looks like it's going to be. In terms of the economics. So that's what we did. And I came into this field because I was approached when the Dawbert ruling came out, saying, you know, you seem to know something about computer processing and handwriting. Maybe you can help this community by seeing how you can develop some automated systems for question document examination. And I said, oh, what a nice challenge. So let me see if I can bring some of those techniques into this domain.
In October 2001, when four anthrax-laced letters arrived at government offices and media outlets in the U.S., investigators were stumped. This handwriting is one of the few clues investigators have to identify the sender. That's why the work of Sargur Srihari is so valuable. He's developed a new computer program which is able to tell whether two documents were written by the same person with 96% accuracy. And for the first time, his work has shown that handwriting is as unique as fingerprints.
It had not been established on a large systematic study, and that's what we were able to establish.
It once took handwriting examiners thousands of hours sifting through thousands of documents to find a match. And since the analysis can be highly subjective, it was often thrown out of U.S. courts, until now.
It provided the objectivity that we needed.
Srihari took writing samples from 1,500 people and scanned them into a computer, which measured quantitative features like letter dimensions and pen pressure. The U.S. Postal System has adapted Shirhari's handwriting recognition system in the hopes of preventing another anthrax scare. The system has broader applications, and it can be used in everything from fraud to murder to forgery investigations. Sharon Navarro, MCTV News, Sudbury.
If a modern expert could match Noel's writing to the ransom notes, this would strongly suggest he was part of the kidnap plot. So Nova asked Sargur Srihari to compare both men's writing with the notes.
A computer can do a lot more more than a document examiner can do.
Srihari's pattern recognition software can isolate words and letters from multiple documents and compare them by precisely measuring their slope, height, width, and contour.
And we have to do that for every letter of the English alphabet.
Srihari analyzed Hauptmann's writing first, taking the begged letters and comparing them to six of the ransom notes.
The results of comparison of the ransom notes and Hauptmann writing are shown here at the individual letter pair level and as well as the individual character level.
Each comparison gets a score. Positive values indicate a higher probability the writing is from the same person. Negative values, a lower probability.
For instance, the letter pair AM or AM has a fairly high negative score, indicating that they don't seem to be written by the same individual. There are some positives as well. So what matters is the sum total of all of these things, and that total turns out to be negative, indicating that it's unlikely that Hauptmann wrote the ransom notes.
If Srihari is correct, then Hauptmann did have a co-conspirator who wrote the notes. And could it be John Knoll? Srihari's initial analysis of Knoll's writing showed some positives for the word John, but other comparisons did not.
What we did here was to compare pairs of letters, such as an ER and NO and so on. And we're also comparing ST again with a negative value. The summary of these comparisons is that it is unlikely that John Knoll was the writer of these ransom notes.
Srihari's conclusion does not completely eliminate Knoll as a suspect. But it means John Douglas must dig deeper into Knoll's story to prove he's a lost kidnapper.
Good afternoon, good evening, I suppose, in Malaysia, good morning in the UK, and it's afternoon here in India.
Okay. Good afternoon. Today's topic is counterfactuals in artificial intelligence. Good morning, everyone. So today is the second lecture on the topic of approximate inference. This is the second lecture on robust artificial intelligence. Thank you very much. Enjoyed it.
Stu Shapiro, who's an Emeritus Professor in the Computer Science and Engineering Department and a former chair of the CS Department and the CSE Department, the Computer Science and Engineering Department. Stu has been in Buffalo as a faculty member since 1977 and the year, I think, before Hari joined the department. Stu, would you please come and share your thoughts about
Thank you, Barat. First, let's get the elephant out of the room. Ari and I did not see eye to eye on AI. So I always believed and still do in what Professor Jane called AI, which is the attempt to get computers to behave in the full range of human level, at least cognitive behavior, in which I especially concentrated on representation of beliefs, their derivation from natural language interaction, and their use in natural language interaction, reasoning, and acting. Whereas Hari took what I would call, and I think what he would call, the engineering approach to solving particular tasks, which you've seen discussed all afternoon. I remember being particularly blown away when he told me that he had received from the post office, from the postal service, a huge stack of tapes of every single address in the United States. So reading an address became a problem of picking which address it was, as opposed to reading de novo what the address was. Leaving that aside, Ari was an excellent departmental citizen. He served as acting chair in 87-88 when I was on sabbatical, when I was chair and on sabbatical. He entirely in his own initiative edited a series of what he called departmental research reviews, which were pamphlets in which various faculty members discussed the research they were carrying out. And especially interesting, he put together the list of faculty members and their ranks in the department at the time. And this proved invaluable when we were developing the 50-year timeline of the department, so we could track all the faculty members that had been in the department from Hari's documents. Another extremely noteworthy thing that he did is, even though CEDAR was bringing in a huge amount of research support and had a really big organization swamping essentially the rest of the department, he resisted efforts by the administration to have CEDAR be considered a separate organization. And he insisted that, no, CEDAR was a part of the computer science department. And so he was an extremely valuable colleague to have all these years. And I was entirely shocked at his passing, and we'll miss him.
As my personal observation, it is both Hari and Stu who put UB on the map of artificial intelligence. And Stu is very well known and regarded in the field for his contributions to knowledge representation and reasoning. Next, I would like to request Professor Andre Soom to make a few remarks. Andre was a professor mechanical engineering, mechanical and aerospace engineering, UB, and he was also a former associate dean of the School of Engineering and Applied Sciences, and he also knew Hari very well. Andre, please.
Well, I have no opinions of my own regarding AI, except I do remember there was a seminar that my advisor held in 1970 when I was a beginning grad student on AI, and I vaguely remember being told how it might one day take over the world, but I guess it didn't. But, you know, there's time. I knew Harry for nearly 30 years as a colleague, much of it while I was Associate Dean of Research and Grad Education in Engineering. He was also a neighbor, living some 10 houses down the street from us. You saw Meadowview Lane 276, where we were 162, still are. And he was a friend. Our children were in high school at the same time. His son Ashok and my son Adam played trombone in the school bands. We were just reminiscing a little bit about that when I came in. We did not socialize extensively, but I clearly remember one time my mother was visiting for the holidays, and Hari kindly invited us to join the family for a New Year's Eve celebration. Everyone was very welcoming. Some people sang karaoke. I don't remember what Hari did, except that that Hari was especially charming. All evening, he kept telling anybody who would listen how attractive and youthful my 88-year-old mother was. So it was no surprise afterwards, and that for the rest of her life, she would always ask after Hari. We had our longest conversations usually on the street when either Rohini and he or Mary and I were out walking the neighborhood. And he and Rohini used to take mammoth walks, see him in one corner of the neighborhood and then an hour later in another, still walking. I remember that as I was preparing to retire and afterwards after I had, Hari probed me in great detail about my retiree life and my thinking and everything. He always made it sound like retirement was just around the corner for him. I began to suspect after a while, however, that the retiree life that I was describing for him was less than compelling. So he kept working. I've often remarked after my almost complete withdrawal from university life, after having really enjoyed it for a long time, that maybe if I had been better at some of the things that I did, maybe I would have still kept at it, but anyway. Certainly, I wasn't anywhere near the league of Hari in terms of accomplishments. As a colleague, and some of these things have been said, there are a few themes that I wrote down, themes of generosity and personal warmth and university citizenship, and of course, the size of CEDAR did dominate in quantitative terms, not just the computer science and the CSE department, but also the School of Engineering. It really was just CEDAR and the Earthquake Research Center were the only two large-scale research activities that actually were measurable in the research firmament of the School of Engineering. And of course, we've heard how he was generous and sharing those resources, also even across departments. While I watched some faculty members angling for ways to pay as little as possible in support of their research assistance and tuition and indirect costs and IFR, et cetera, et cetera. These matters, at least to my view, never seemed to be an issue with Harry. He always just did what needed to be done. Didn't ask for very much in the way of, if any, special consideration. He also was generous with his time. We needed a presentation from the Dean's Advisory Council. He would always step forward, and he made us all look good. So despite his high stature, he was a most agreeable colleague. Our final conversation last year was, I can't even remember if it was April or July, 10 years of retirement, I'll do that too. I was on a walk and ran into him at the end of his driveway, and we must have chatted for 30, 40 minutes. We hadn't seen each other for a while, including in part due to COVID, and we had our typical wide-ranging conversation, talking about work and family and university and the state of the world, and he was full of enthusiasm and plans and hope. And that memory of him is one that we'll happily carry me forward.
Thank you, Andre. I'll next request Professor Raj Acharya to share a few remarks. Raj was a professor in the former EC department and then also chaired the Computer Science and Engineering department before going on to Penn State, where he was the head of the School of Computing and Information Systems, and now he's the Associate Vice Provost for Research at Indiana University. Raj, please.
Thank you for providing me an opportunity to say a few words about Hari. During 1985, I was finishing up my PhD thesis at Mayo Medical School in Rochester, Minnesota. You must be wondering why I should have head examined, because it's Rochester, Minnesota, cold weather from Bangalore, but I did that. And later I moved to Buffalo, so I was going in the right direction. So while I was doing my PhD thesis, it was on the spatiotemporal reconstruction of the beating heart. And this was a national and international project. 100 people from United States, Europe, and Indian Institute of Science and Israel were working on it. And the idea was that there was a voxel, a true computation of the property of the voxel as a function of time. And you might not know that the largest group outside of the Mayo at that time was at SUNY Buffalo, Computer Science Department. It was called MIPG, Medical Image Processing Group. There were about 25 faculty and research scientists headed by Gabor Herman. And it practically 80% of all the algorithms in today's MRI, CT machines comes out of the group at SUNY Buffalo as well as at Mayo. Now, why did I talk about this? The reason I talked about this was while I was working on my thesis, and I had to work on the voxel, and there was a seminal paper by Hari, very highly cited in the ACM computing surveys, representation of 3D digital images. And there was a very strong PhD thesis of his student on arc trees and how you represent volumes in a hierarchical fashion. And this is a particular data structure for this one. And so I finished my PhD thesis, and during the time, You know, my first introduction to Hari as a scientist was via this paper and this thesis. And I was, of course, aware completely of the stacks and stacks of progress reports from the CS department at UB, from the Gabor Herman's group. And Hari, though he was not part of this group, was inspired by MIPG. Now, when I finished my thesis, there were a group of people from France, Thompson, who were in my thesis defense, and they offered me a position to go to France in their think tank, Thompson's think tank. And I worked on what's called the octree machine, fast visualization of octree machine. And I was very much aware of Hari's work on this one. So I presented my paper in ICPR in 1986. I already had my job offer at SUNY Buffalo, and I'd come here. And I see Hari in ICPR in Paris. And there was this very famous debate between Dreyfus, Douglas Hofstadter, and a few others on the AI part of it. The great philosopher Dreyfus from Berkeley, and Douglas Hofstadter, who wrote Beautiful Esther Bach. Anyhow, the point was, I went and introduced myself to Hari and said that I have accepted the job at SUNY Buffalo, and I'm coming in, and I'm looking forward to working with you. And Hari was very, very happy, very warmly welcomed me to come to Buffalo. And when I joined here, he became a mentor. And we would see each other in the corridor. And we would, you know, he made me, at the beginning, junior faculty, introduced me to Levitt and made me one of the associate editors of the General Lab Computerized Medical Imaging and Graphics, because at that time, you need some connections when you're a junior faculty. Hari always was very positive. So I'll give you an example. 1999, Stanley Cup Finals. You all know what I'm talking about, because the goal was not allowed, right? And Sabres did lose it. But what was Hari's take? His take was, I'm very glad that Sabres were in the final and they were about to clinch the cup. So Hari always looked at the positives, and I think this etched in my mind. So I'm going to switch gears and talk about Professor Kashyap, who came in and visited us. This was down in Baldy Hall. The studio was in Baldy Hall. Hari and I were walking with Kashyap, and Kashyap, who is a very famous person in patent recognition, is very well known from Purdue University. He happens to be my mentor too. And he introduced me to Fu and a few others, but that's a different story. So as we were walking in the corridor, Kashyap was completely impressed by the enormous size of the group. This was even before Commons. Just the Baldy Hall size was formidable. And Hari, and Kashyap turned to me and Hari and said, Srihari is a Palegara. Now, Palegara in Kannada means a lord, somebody who has achieved a status of leading a huge group leadership. So this resonated with Hari and myself, because we spoke the same language. Now, I didn't know at that time, but I realized when I came to Buffalo that Hari and I belong to a small community called Hebarangas. This is a very small community. And if you do plot the computer graph, the Hebaranga graph, the diameter of that Hebaranga graph is at most 3. So what does this mean? It means that the 3 halves, we are related to each other. So this is even tighter constraint than the Kevin Bacon number. So I now move on to the last few sentences, which is, in Hinduism, there is a particular interpretation of the word dharma. And this interpretation of dharma is the raison d'etre of an individual is called the dharma. The real reason for existence of an individual is called dharma. And what is Hari's raison d'etre? What is Hari's dharma? And I posit, based on all the things I heard today, it's pattern recognition, machine learning, and building real systems that work. Hari might not be here, but his systems are. Thank you.
Students from the late 90s to the present day. There are many of them, just a few of them. Unfortunately, some of the people we invited could not be here today. The first speaker is Harish Srinivasan, who's at Amazon. Harish didn't come at the last minute, but he sent me a video which I will play now.
Hello everyone, this is Harish Srinivasan, one of Dr. Srihari's former PhD students. It's a great honor to be presenting some of Dr. Srihari's work. I will focus on the work that I had the privilege to work with him, which is mainly in the area of computational forensics using handwriting. This is a picture of Dr. Srihari with some of his PhD students right there. This is about 15 years ago, about the same time, in a CEDAR lab. CEDAR was founded by Dr. Srihari, Center of Excellence for Document Analysis and Recognition, and I worked with him from 2002 when I joined graduate school until I graduated in 2008. So computational forensics, the main definition comes from the cognitive abilities of human expertise modeled using computational methods, and specifically for the application in forensics. Now back in the days, forensics primarily was involved with DNA and other biometrics like fingerprints and so on. But often what happened was a lot of evidence in forensics could be found with handwriting, ransom notes and other information and signatures and so on. And there was a need for a scientific methodology to be able to look at handwriting samples. And in fact, people in the field who were doing this expert work were called question document examiners. And Dr. Srihari's pioneering work in this field was published of how computational methods can be used for this purpose in general forensic science. He also had a book on this and several peer-reviewed journals and conference papers. Now, the importance of handwriting in forensics really was evident because back in the days, the justice statistics mentioned that among 50 largest publicly funded crime labs, the majority of them perform question document function. And Dr. Srihari was always wanting to work backward from a real problem. And the situation here is that you have a question document that you don't know who wrote it. And you have some known suspect handwriting that you know who it is associated with. And the experts will take the question document and try to compare it with known suspects. And similarly for signatures as well. And there was it's a very labor-intensive, highly skilled work. The question was, can we do this in a faster way with the same scientific methodologies that experts were using? Now, the right to verification problem, which was basically you're given a known document that you know the source or the person who wrote it, and the question document. to be able to compare them and say a yes or a no. They were written by the same person or they were not. And that's obviously quite a hard problem because two samples written by the same person itself have some variance. And two samples written by different people would have like even more variance. And this is the essence of identifying the individuality of handwriting, which is also a paper done by Dr. Srihari several years ago. Now, he always believed in all of the research work needs to have a closure, that is to be able to have all the work be put in a tool that can be practically used by the people in the field. So such a system was this CEDAR Fox system. CEDAR Fox stands for Forensic Examination, built by the CEDAR Labs team. And this software was one where question document examiners could use for writer verification and identification. It could compute probability and strength of evidence for comparing documents. It could have a lot of document properties listed. It could do signature verification and document search and many such things. Specifically on using machine learning, Dr. Srihari was a heavy proponent of having these statistical evidence-based work. And when you're comparing two documents such as what is over here, the question document examiners often wanted to see how one individual property, such as slant of the handwriting or a specific stroke, how would that compare with the other known sample. And they wanted to be able to individually look at the contribution of each characteristics of handwriting towards the evidence. And again, working backwards from this need, Dr. Srihari was a big proponent of taking a Bayesian method because you could treat certain properties as independent. And that is how the system was built, which was the examiners could toggle off or on the features to compare the different properties of handwriting to see whether one or more is adding or taking away the evidence of the match. In performing these demos to the question document examiners, often they used to get feedback. Can you do signature matching, for example? And originally this was not in the system, and taking the feedback from the users, the team worked on being able to not just compare full pages of handwriting, but just a signature. So if you have a known set of signature, and then you have a sample that you want to see whether it's a forgery or it's not, then how do you develop methodologies where you can compare and provide a probability that this is a forgery or not? There was also interest in extending the work from the English language to other languages, such as Arabic. And the team created the CEDAR Arabic system, an equivalent of the CEDAR Fox system, but for the Arabic language. And there are other extensions in this work to take a document and let's say it has a signature at the bottom of it, but how do you extract the signature? If it's a scanned document and you want to be able to extract the signature, the team utilizes some advanced state-of-the-art machine learning techniques such as conditional random fields to be able to segment a document and extract the signature and then use this signature as a query to be able to retrieve other documents where this signature was a match. So it's a very pioneering work using advanced ML, you know, in the space of handwriting. Lastly, and I just want to summarize some key lessons that myself and many others have learned working with Dr. Srihari. One is always to work backwards from a problem and not do research for the sake of research, but always take a problem that is of practical value and work on the problem and see if you can build tools that you can give back to the community for them to be able to use it. And continuously take user feedback like signatures, required, something like that. So you always take user feedback and continuously improve the system that you are building. But at the same time, you continuously advance the scientific innovative component of the team. Always working on the state-of-the-art techniques, but making sure that the appropriate techniques were used such that the people who are using the system can also be benefited. So I have learned quite a lot from working with Dr. Srihari, and it's a big loss for the community, but his memories and lessons will always remain. Thank you very much.
Thing about him as a research advisor was his ground-to-earth nature.
I enjoyed listening to him sharing his own experience when he was a PhD student. I also appreciate his openness to ideas. He never outright rejects any idea. He was open to new directions and techniques if there is a valid reason and plausible way of doing it. He didn't expect immediate updates, but he always was there when I needed him. The impact he has on me is far greater than purely academic one. I have learned discipline, manners, and judgments from him. I wish I told him the many ways in which he was truly great PhD supervisor. It turns out that many nominations, awards, and jobs were all influenced to a greater or lesser extent by Professor. The support has never stopped. In closing, Professor Sargur Srihari has been a role model to me. I am very proud to have had a chance to work with a legend, and I truly miss his presence in my dissertation defense, where I now have a responsibility to carry forward the legacy of Professor Sargur Srihari. Thank you, Mihir, for those nice remarks. I'd like to request another of students, Nitin, Kulkarni, to.
Respected faculty, my dear fellow students and guests. I was very fortunate to have known Professor Srihari, to have him had as my advisor and my mentor, even though it was for a very short time. I'm also real grateful to the department faculty for their continued support in this difficult time. Well, due to the pandemic, my initial contacts with Professor Srihari were mostly virtual. I took his course on neurosymbolic AI, and it was just fascinating to hear him, you know, teach and talk about these topics enthusiastically, and I could see that passion for teaching. Well, while completing my master's, I developed an interest towards pursuing a PhD degree. And upon talking to my fellow students, I just heard very good things about Professor Srihari. I approached Professor Srihari, and he was very kind, and he accepted me to be his PhD student. And I remember the first time I met him in person in May 2021, I was very impressed with how kind he was, how he had this happy sort of vibe, the smile on his face, always. Well, his research work, the more I read about his research work and his contributions to the field of pattern recognition, the more I appreciated his talents. He was truly a pillar in the Department of Computer Science, and his knowledge benefited not only me, but many students who came here before me. I remember vividly the first time I discussed my research plans with him. I was at that time very interested in reinforcement learning, and Professor Srihari didn't know much about that topic, but he was interested in causal inference and neurosymbolic AI. I found a way to sort of combine these two different topics, and he listened to me talk about everything enthusiastically. And he supported me in following what interested me and offered me valuable guidance in the right direction. Professor Srihari, if you're listening from above, I would like to thank you for everything that you have taught me and tell you how fortunate I am to have known.
Segment, you know, of the symposium, which is a short panel discussion, and I'll request the moderator, Professor Dave Newman, who is the director for the Institute of the AI and Data Sciences at UP and also a professor in the CSE department, to please come and to welcome the panelists.
We could have the panelists. grab a seat while I'm introducing the panel. So, good afternoon, and welcome to this panel on the AI, the past, the present, and the future. I want to thank Romini and the organizers for inviting myself and these young scientists that we're going to have up here to be part of this celebration for our friend and colleague, Harry. So, would you each grab a seat there? Unfortunately, I think we have to share two mics with the three of you, but what I'd like to do is I start by introducing the panel. What I'll do is I'll introduce each one and then have them give you their title and how they met Harry and how long they've known him in what capacity. But for those of you that don't know me, my name is Dr. David Dorman. I'm a professor in computer science and engineering and the director of the AI and Data Science Institute. One of the reasons that I came here to Buffalo was because of Harry and his legacy, the students that I knew, Wenu, Ranga, Harry himself, people that have been my colleagues throughout my career before I came here in 2018. And I distinctly remember when I met Harry, it was on a panel, the U.S. Postal Service, when they were doing the research between his first project that you heard about today and the establishment of CEDAR. They also had a number of research conferences, and they produced big proceedings of papers, and that was one of my first papers, my first presentations was down in Washington, D.C. I only had to travel from College Park to downtown to the Postal Service, where there was a group of well-renowned researchers that were focusing on this problem. And I distinctly remember him being on the panel, Theo Pavlidis being the person that was chairing the session. And as I went over my allotted 10 minutes by 30 seconds, Theo would just keep walking closer and closer and closer. And I remember Harry just sitting there laughing next to me, because they knew that this was one of the things that graduate students really shouldn't do. Okay, so why don't I go ahead and start introducing. So in no particular order, Elena Prosheka.
Hello, everybody. First, I'm very pleased to be here, and I was very lucky to have a lot of interactions with Dr. Sargur Srihari, and it's a very big loss for everybody, but he made a lot of contribution and provide a lot of inspiration to many of us, and me particularly. Should I go with one story or just introduction?
Let's just start with the introductions, and then okay. we'll start with some questions that will prime some of that.
That's very good, yeah.
So. Okay, and Chen?
Hi. Hello everyone. Thank you for having me here. So I have been working with Harry since I joined in UB in 2017. I have some discussion with him regarding both the teaching and some research ideas. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, and third we have Souvik Das.
Hi everybody, I'm Souvik Das, second year PhD student in the department, and I'm deeply honored to be in the panel today, and I have known Professor Harry from 2019 when I took his class, and thereafter he was very interested in neurosymbolic AI, and he recently agreed to be on my committee member, and we recently started discussion about several approaches of neurosymbolic AI.
All right, so before we get started, the fourth person that you see on the agenda there, Deepak Kumar, was a student, I believe, of Stu's back in the mid-90s. He's currently chair, I believe, of CS at Bryn Mawr. Unfortunately, 2 days ago, he sort of came down with a fever, decided that he couldn't travel, and then things got worse today, so he couldn't even join us by Zoom, but he did say and send his deepest condolences, Rohini, to you and your family, and anybody that he knew that was here. He's sorry that he missed you, and hopefully sometime in the future he'll be able to cross paths again. Okay, so why don't we get started? So today we've heard a lot about Harry, about his approach to research, his approach to teaching, the impact that he's made on his generation of students, and a little bit about what those students have gone on to do and his comments. But really, we heard from several people that his legacy is not only going to be the people that he interacted with directly, but also those people that he educated to be professors, to be researchers, to be thought leaders, and to be ones that are going to move AI forward. So the organizers decided, rather than bring a bunch of old people like myself up here to talk about where AI is going to be, they wanted to bring these young scientists, these young impressionable students and faculty members that were mentored or interacted with Harry, to give you some ideas about what he thinks we need to do to move forward with AI, whether it be symbolic, whether it be statistical, and where that is going to move in the future. So I prepared a few questions that, knowing sort of how we've been interacting over the past few weeks, I've talked to a number of people that knew Harry much better than I had. So I'm going to start with you, Chenyu. So as we all know, education is one of Harry's passions, and he was especially passionate about his deep learning courses, and in particular, you know, his machine learning courses, and that impact that he has on students. So I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your interactions with him since you've come here, and what you got in terms of what he should be teaching and what you should be teaching the next generation as we move forward.
First of all, I have to say, Harry is a great person and great educator, and he's so, always so kind and open to the students, and he always wants to design the best course and find the best way to teach the deep learning course. So I remember when I first came here in 2017, so I needed to choose a course to teach, and so because my background is in deep learning, so the deep learning course is a bit a good fit to me, but I didn't have too much experience for teaching, so I approached Harry and asked him about the question about the how to teach the course and how to design the materials, including the slides, etc. And he was so open-minded, and he was so willing to tell me everything he wants to say. So he also pointed me he was actually maintaining a website about this course. He had put everything useful in the website, including the slides and some related work. And I actually went through all of those materials, and I found was very insightful and helpful. And so that actually helped me a lot in preparing my course. Regarding the maybe the views and also the goal of his the education, I think Harry is so fascinating, and he always wants to find to bring in the state of art approaches and to teach that to the students. And he believes so that the students not only need to understand the techniques from a theoretical way, but also they should need to understand them and need to know how to apply them to practical problems. So I think that's why he always has a component in his course, which is the a final project to solve some real problems. And he is kind of proud about this part, because he always invited our faculty to his students' project presentation. And of course, at last, he always sent us a summary of what the student has done, and also pointed out some interesting projects. And I found this kind of component also really helpful to educate students, and which I adopted in my own course. So overall, I think Harry is no doubt a great educator and also a great researcher, and he's always the pioneer of the state-of-art techniques. So from the past pattern recognition techniques to the current state-of-art deep learning techniques, including his like symbolic-based AI approach. So I think he actually advocating such kind of approach, which I think is an essence of the what the artificial general intelligence needs. So yeah, so he's always kind of fostering the future leader of AI, and I think he did.
Okay, thank you. Elena, you were also, as a graduate student, teaching reinforcement learning, which I know was another of one of Harry's passions. And I'm sure that most of the students that were taking this were either taking his courses in parallel. Can you give us some insight into how you interacted with him on courses such as reinforcement learning?
Yeah, absolutely. I first want to say that Professor Srihari, he always had a very good feeling of what is going to be the future of AI, and I think that he thought a lot about it, that he made some presentations about that, and he had a very good feeling of where is the directions is going. He always educated himself, he always looked for some new ways of, or some new topics, and I think it was one of something also that inspires me as well to always stay on top of what is happening these days in the research field of AI. And at some point when I took his deep learning course, and I was very lucky to took his, he would call it trilogy. He would have a machine learning course, advanced machine learning course, and deep learning course. And he would say that this is like my trilogy of my courses. I was very lucky to interact with each of these courses in different ways. And as part of his deep learning course, he always, like at that point, motivated and talked a lot about reinforcement learning and the importance of this field as part of his course. And this was a very big inspiration to develop a new whole course that we currently run in our department. And I'm very happy that this course was first offered 2 years ago, and since then we have it every semester. It has a lot of attention from the students, and the big influence of this course was definitely based on Harry's inputs and his ideas and suggestions, and many of his teaching style that he used in terms of interacting with students, keeping open projects, motivating students to try something on their own, also motivates and something that I adopted for my courses that I offer these days. And so he made a lot of influence in that. He also recently, one of his recent topic was on neurosymbolic AI, and he also was very advocating about these directions, and he had again a very good intuition on behind what is going to be of a high interest and what is going to be the future of AI. So it's so he made again a lot of inputs, and it's nice that his motivation is going to inspire other generations of AI experts in the future.
Great, thank you. I think that your point about him adapting his teaching style and what he intends to learn or intends to teach for the next generation of students is very good observation, because he did exactly that. Okay, so Sovik, I understand that you were assisting Harry, you were a student of his in the neurosymbolic AI area. That's part of what your PhD thesis is on. And you were involved with, to some extent, with his course. Could you tell us a little bit more about what neurosymbolic AI is, what its importance is, and how you got involved with it?
Yeah, sure. So initially I had a little interaction with Professor Hari, but my advisor is Professor Rohini. She came to me and told this is the area that is very much advancing. So we should look into that area, neurosymbolic AI. And you see much of these successful deep learning models these days are based on simply inspired from these biological neural networks, but these deep learning models have eclipsed earlier approach of AI that is called symbolic AI, which treats these worldly entities as predefined set of symbols, and uses kind of a inference based on logic and say probabilistic reasoning. So symbolic approach is very much beneficial to address some of the issues of deep learning, and it addresses the deep learning issues to some extent, increasing the adaptability or say generalizability, etc. But it has its own limitations. It is very difficult to build you need to write a lot of rules to build this kind of a system. So here Professor Hari motivated the learning or to learn about this concept neurosymbolic AI. So he very often cited a book called Thinking Fast and Slow by famous Nobel laureate by Daniel Kahneman. So in this book what the author describes is human thinking two possible ways. One way is thinking fast, which is very prone to errors. And another way of thinking is thinking slow, whenever we are doing doing some very important decision, buying a house or buying a car, something like that. We think properly and make a good decision at the time. So simply this kind of faculties, fast and slow thinking, can be extended to AI, this neurosymbolic AI, which is this fast and slow thinking is a core concept of neurosymbolic AI, where this deep learning, which is the slow thinking, the fast thinking way, and this symbolic AI, which is the slow thinking way, and marry these two domains of AI, then neurosymbolic AI is born. So in this domain, using this neurosymbolic AI, it has lot of advantages. We need less training data, as well as it can have more accuracy than humans, and at the same time it is quite explainable. So this was kind of an introduction to neurosymbolic AI, and where Professor Hari was interested, was very proponent of using this deep learning method as well as this neurosymbolic AI. So he told me these models, many of us know this kind of model, GPT-2 and GPT-3. These are very much predominant in natural language processing these days. And people are coming up with more models, more and more models. But if you see these models, it will perform to some extent, but these models, when they are provided with some data, with some examples, which are very much distributionally different from whatever the data it is trained on, so it performs weakly. So Professor Hari was very enthusiastic to combine these two methods, deep learning and neurosymbolic AI, and he suggested if you combine, do a fusion between these two methods, and that will propel AI in the forward direction.
You want to comment also? Okay, great. Yeah, and I'll agree with that 100%. I was at a DARPA workshop a couple of weeks ago, and there were some experiments that people have published showing that GPT-3, it's tens of millions of dollars to train it, 20% of power in this one particular area to train it, but if you give it two-digit numbers to multiply together, because it hasn't seen that before, it can't deal with those types of questions. So there's a lot of those types of questions that need to be asked. In my interactions with Harry, he realized, he even said at one time, the machine learning, the deep learning, those are the core mathematics, those are the baselines of AI. And so, Stu, for some hope for your approach, I think Harry was coming around to knowing that the types of things that he was doing would solve this narrow AI, but not necessarily the more general intelligence that we hope to be artificial intelligence. So Elena, let me have another question for you. So Harry was very proud of, you know, Buffalo's contribution to AI. You've heard that when I first got here, the 2018 talk. He mentioned that a lot. And so you've worked with him. Can you tell us about what he saw AI going, and in particular, the belief that everybody's going to work in an AI world in the future? So what do we need to teach our students in the future about AI to make it successful?
Yeah, first, it's a very good point that for our courses that Professor Hara was offering, he would always highlight the importance of Buffalo role in the terms of development of AI, and it was very inspirational for me personally. And this is what I also adopted for to use in my courses. So in my courses, I ensure to highlight that in Buffalo at UB, we do have a lot of very big concepts that was developed, and I think it's very important that our current students know the success of our alumnus. And I know that Haruhi was very proud and was always like telling that UB was like a very key point at some time, especially when there was a project related to USP. It was USPS, and there was a lot of very big things happening in that was happening like right here and that was born here at UB. About the future, here I would also like use some of the thoughts and ideas that was suggested by Deepak, who cannot join us today, but he shared some very good thoughts. About the future, one of the things that I think that Professor Harab might like thought of is the combination of not just using like neural networks, but also apply some neurosymbolism behind it, and ideally using some neurosymbolic approach to solve our real-world problems. We cannot just solve it efficiently, but also do a very good explainability and show why some particular model make particular decisions. And that is what is also very important for industry, just to not just to make a good prediction, but also be ready to explain different things. One also thing is the usage of hardware technologies, and given that these days our hardware develops very well, and as we had an example today, very many years ago, having some hardware with 10 GB was a very big success. These days we are lucky to have very powerful GPU services that are able to help and to train very complex models and services. And also as part of Harry's courses, he always motivated students to first work with the real-world problems to solve the actual problem that are there in industries and to try to have some nice results and nice solutions for that. So I think that the future of AI would be related to know that people should know how these tools are working first in order to understand why we got recommended the particular things, or got used to some things. And also one of the also main aspect is that people should understand the main concepts behind AI and be ready to apply and start with some very simple models and possibly do a very good explainability and work with more complex models. So he was again a very big promoting of AI and very big promoting that there was a lot of connections of AI in Buffalo, that was born in Buffalo, and it was always very, very inspiring and very nice. And it's also interesting that I know that Harry, he was took the very, whenever I would see him, he would always have some reading some news about AI. He was have a very good feelings of what is happening in the field these days, and he was very much closely looking on the recent topics, recent research, and this was also very inspiring, and this is what he also put to his student that you need to, like he showed how the AI can be applicable directly in the systems or directly in the in our real, like in our everyday lives, I would say.
Okay, thank you. Chengyu, I'm going to grab that mic from you. And so we have a few extra minutes here, and so I think I'm going to ask Bharat if you can hold this this mic. If anybody from the audience has any questions, if you kind of make your way up here, I will not try to dominate the rest of the panel. You've got three excellent representatives of people that are fairly new to Buffalo up here. If you have any questions, please just come up here and ask. Otherwise, I'll continue with a couple of other questions I might have. Don't be shy. Okay.
Okay, so the discussion of thinking fast and slow that was made actually aligns with the topic that I was most wishing to approach Hari with, because in the past few months I formulated a simple four-word way to phrase it. And the question is, do model designers satisfice, especially those not ingrained in larger research projects, go just as far as needed to attack and solve a problem, but maybe not with inbuilt robustness that would be needed for further applications of the model to other problems in nearby space? And is this an issue where the replication crisis touches on this field?
That's an excellent question, actually. So, so right now, what is happening is in this field of neurosymbolic AI, people are coming up with, say, a lot of these frameworks. And we're dabbling with a lot of frameworks, and there's no generic framework per se. So designing this fast and, say, slow ways of thinking into model is not perfectly ingrained in the in these models of neurosymbolic AI. But to some extent, some of the models are doing it, because if you see some of these visual question answering models, where the like it parses the questions, like the questions or say the images are parsed as a question of the questions, like it's parsed into programs, and these programs are executed. So this execution of this program might be a part of slow thinking. And the fast thinking is like very simple, like any of these deep learning models are, say, mimicking fast thinking. So I would say it is not yet solved. A lot of problems are there, and a lot of work needs to be done. Yeah, did I answer your question?
Well, I think there are more aspects to what I'm
asking. Yeah.
For instance, I see very many academic papers that build a model and the model's wrong. It's one particular one that's intersected with me, and I've not had time to write my huge reputation of it.
Right.
But I'm wondering how much this tendency to do things by the book and write and yet achieve results that are brittle and at break or did not have enough data.
Yeah, so yeah, there's a lot of work needs to be done, I think. So it is not yet solved, this removing this idea.
Anybody else have any questions? Okay, so anybody that's, I'll kind of give a general question to the panel here to finish up. Anybody that knows why I came here, when I interviewed with Satish, with the chair of CSE and our previous dean, was because I see a world where everyone is going to be working with AI. And Harry and I had a number of discussions about this. He thought, you know, the fundamentals of AI need to be in CSE, but the applications are everywhere. And I think that's the one point that we both agreed on. And so how do we take the knowledge that we have and he's built and the students have built here and move it forward and apply it in other domains? How do we start speaking other people's languages? How do we teach them to understand AI? How do we teach them? This week, we have two AI Institute proposals going into NSF that are very important there. But I think I want to ask in general, you know, we have a rolling definition of artificial intelligence. There's a lot of things that people wouldn't consider, and we've heard that today, to be AI anymore, right? Maybe digit recognition, or at least machine-printed digit recognition. Even that's, though that's something that requires human intelligence to solve, and Alexa, and all of those other things, the next generation isn't thinking that way. So what do we need to teach our students to make them understand that AI is an evolution and that it's going in the right direction so we don't suffer another AI winter? That's my general question. If we were going to teach something to all the students at UB, all the students in the community, what kinds of things would that be? What kinds of things that should we teach them?
Maybe I'll start. Well, first, we will definitely have to teach them the basics of Python and, of course, introduction to machine learning, just to explain some basics. And this semester, we have a very huge enrollment in our introduction to machine learning class, which shows that there is a very huge interest from students. And many students coming not just from CSE departments, but from some other departments, and it's a very big very good things to check that there is a lot of interest from people all over other departments. There is one more interesting thing that Hari was very inspired of, and he was very inspired to talk about the different level of software. So he was telling that there is software 1.0, and it is the how we traditionally develop our code and how we traditionally develop our program. And there is also software 2.0, where we don't explicitly write the code, but when we just say what should be our input, what is the desired output, we pass this as the objective functions to our neural network structure, and the neural network basically generates the code for us. And Professor Srihari, he was always very enthusiastic about this idea. This idea came from Enrico Prati, and he was very excited about this idea. And I know that as part of his machine learning course, one of the first assignments would be related to literally implement a FISBUS problem, which is traditional solved using sequential programming, using neural network. And that was a very interesting experience, and I think it's a good example of how to first teach students to work in, or how to teach students to look at AI from different perspectives, and show that some of the problems, they can be solved using artificial intelligence very efficiently. Show, and again, this today that we saw the idea of USPS project that can help to automate a lot of very routine work and do it very efficiently. This also can do a lot, provide a lot of inspiration to students. I also think that students need to first, and this is what also was inspired by Hari, to have a lot of practical experience of working with different fields, show where the current state of the art is, and then let students explore. And Hari, he was, especially for his advanced level courses, he always provided a lot of freedom to what kind of projects you can work, and I think it's also very inspirational and helpful to try different things, see how they try different solutions. You might not get the right solution right away, but the main idea that you try, check different approaches, and this also brings a lot of interest from students as it is. So I think that one of the first things that beyond that we need to teach, like some fundamental courses like Python, machine learning concepts, but also provide students opportunities to give it a try different things. It is okay if it will not work in like perfectly, but give this freedom to students to try build systems on their own, ideally with some real world application. And I hope that this will also help to motivate students to explore later, even when they graduate, to explore later different more complex applications.
So I want to add that maybe we should first make the students realize that we are actually AI is the future, and because we are using AI every day. So say for example if you are using your phone, you are actually using for example, to use the face recognition or speech recognition to unlock your phone, and also you. So what I want to say is that AI has actually has been applied in everywhere. Although someone might argue that it's not artificial general intelligence yet, but they are quite useful, and in some fields they actually have outperformed human beings significantly. So what I want to say is that we are not in the artificial general intelligence yet, but we are on the way. So I believe that in the future we will reach right there.
Okay, great. So in a matter of time and the constraints that we have for this room, I just want to say that Harry, you've gotten a glimpse today from these panelists, from the speakers, of your legacy as an educator, as a researcher, and you should be very proud. So let's thank the panelists. And now I'd like to invite Jun Wei, the chair of computer science, to offer some closing remarks.
Thank you, Lynn. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jun Wei Xu. I'm currently serving as the chair of the UPCC department. Let me begin by thanking everyone for coming to attend this symposium in honor of Sargur Srihari. Given the COVID situation, I know it's very difficult for many of you to come here and attend this event. Really appreciate your support. I know it means a lot to the Srihari families and also to the CEC department. From the talks, presentations, and the panel discussions we have reviewed the Harry's extraordinary academic life and a scholarly achievement, it clearly suggested that Harry was a giant in the field of AI and machine learning, especially in the subfield of pattern recognition, document analysis, and computational forensics. His research findings have brought global renown to UB and has put our department at the frontiers of those areas. Even though we have known Harry's work for a long time, just hearing them in attendees, his stories, his seminar works, is still very fresh to us. It makes us feel that how lucky we are to have the opportunities to work with Harry and be his colleagues, which gives us the opportunity to learn and benefit from Harry's wisdom for so many years. For that, I want to thank Harry. Harry's footprint will be with us forever. He has introduced a number of this AI machine learning course to our department, which will be taught every year, and to educate our students. Also, it is in the planning, so a new endowed scholarship will be established in our department under Harry's name, which will be used to support AI and machine learning graduate students. So every year probably will be about two such students will get supported. And hopefully they will take over whatever kind of Harry left today and make it our department continue to become the leaders in this in these areas. Also, like, you know, there will be a conference rooms in the Davis Hall, which is where the department is like, located, will be named after Harvey's. And that all conference rooms will be used by our faculty and students to for meetings and for even like, you know, having some small size classes. So you know, so that will give us like, you know, like an opportunity to kind of remind, like, you know, so what the Harvey have left, okay, to us. And tomorrow will be Harvey's 73rd birthday. You know, 73 is a special age, okay, in Chinese culture. This is the year when the greatest educator in Chinese history is Confucius. That is the year Confucius dies. So people view it is an honor in Chinese culture if they share the same sensation ages of life with Confucius. So, you know, so in his lifetime, Confucius has taught, like, you know, over 3,000 students, and 72 of them becomes well-known scholars. His philosophy, books, knowledge has influenced the culture, politics, everything of China, as well as the rest of the world for thousands of years. You know, so in the morning, but early, like, you know, professor, like, Andrew James has mentioned this similarity measure, okay? So if we use that matrix, okay, to measure like a similarity between like Confucius and Harvey, we found that the score will be very high. You know, the reason is because we really kind of believe that Harvey is our kind of Confucius. Obviously, Harvey is a great educator. He taught so many students at UB and other a few other places, which definitely exceeded the 3,000, like, you know, so which is the number that, like, you know, Confucius taught. Also, Harvey has supervised like probably hundreds of MS students and over 40 PhD students. Many of them, like, you know, has later on become like prominent like scholars. And many of them actually sitting here. His lectures, notes, and books are also very popular in the AI machine learning community and are used by many people all over the world. For sure, like, you know, so Harvey will continue to positively influence, like, you know, many people's around the world for years to come. You know, for those reasons, like, you know, so I'm sure that Harvey will be dearly missed. I just want to kind of say to Harvey, like, a happy birthday. You know, so it seems like we don't have much time, so, like, you know, I want to kind of, like, you know, share a little bit of kind of my personal kind of interaction with Harvey. Like, you know, I think I joined the department in 2000. I still remember that when I was interviewed like at UBS, I met with Harvey, and Harvey was brought me to this coffee shop in the Commerce, and was talking about the project, talk about his project and his things, and encouraged me to come if I was offered it. And he even said that, you know, he's willing to give me offers, okay, in CEDAR. So lucky enough, like, Roger, like gave me the offer, so I came. And but I was really kind of hesitant to join, like, you know, CEDAR at that time, because I feel that I know nothing about this document analysis. I feel that this is a really a bigger opportunity, a golden opportunity I lost. And I probably this would be, like, you know, so something that I will be regret forever.
Later on, so like, you know, when I was joining the department, like, each time I met Harry, like, he was always encouraging, so like, you know, I remember, like, you know, so during my tenure track period, that is probably the most challenging times from the funding point of view, because that is just like after the IT bubble broke. So the funding rate at the NSF is single digit. So each time, so Harry was always encouraging me. And so, of course, eventually I survived. And also later on, so like, you know, so because I was working in the area of opulence and the geometries, and especially later on, I worked with high dimension geometries, and I found that, you know, that there is a deep connection between like geometries and machine learning. So I was talking with Harris, and because I was really hesitant to kind of expand my research territories to cover like machine learning. So Harvey was very supportive and encouraging. So and now, like, you know, I'm basically working in two areas. One is opulence, one is AI machine learning. So I found that, you know, so this is a fascinating areas to work with. And just like, you know, so feel so kind of thankful to Harris. So this is kind of like my kind of personal kind of note. At the end, I want to thank you for coming to this symposium, and a little later, like, there will be dinners in this Buffalo Marriott Hotel, so just cross the Maple Street, and hope you'll be able to attend and enjoy, like, the dinners. So, and also, like, I want to kind of thank you for coming back to the campus, and I'm not quite sure whether there will be any ceremony for when we rename that conference rooms. So if there will, I probably will share with some of you, hopefully, like, you know, some of you comes. Thank you.
So thank you one and all for coming to the symposium. I also would like to thank the CSE staff and Eva and my co-host Tim Kam Ho, our invited speaker, Professor Anil Jain from Michigan State, all the speakers, and thank you all once again for coming. Have a good evening.